The total number of confirmed coronavirus cases in Lagos State may increase to 120,000 between July and August, the state's health commissioner, Professor Akin Abayomi, has said. While speaking at a press conference on Friday, Abayomi said the virus was expected to reach its peak in Lagos at that time. He also mentioned that there are arrangements to begin a hydrochloroquine trial in the state. He stated that Alimosho, Oshodi, and Isolo local government areas have started having more COVID-19 cases, adding that the majority of dead patients in the state were males. We have back with us on the phone this morning, medical practitioner, Dr. Doherty Orode. Thank you, doctor, for staying with us.
Thank you.
Yeah, I was asking earlier, what more can be done as we face rising numbers on the daily?
I was saying earlier, you know, government just needs to continue to focus on studying this wave, continuing testing so we know where cases are, continue to track them as well as contact trace so that we can proactively and adequately prepare. Study what other countries are doing, other successful countries that have really focused on being humane and then determining what works best for their own country. So what has failed in our own regard, we need to be aware of. We think about preparing palliative plans and continuing to do these palliative plans because we have a mostly poor population. We should determine, you know, if we need to pivot our plans for admitting all positive cases into isolation centers based on where we are. You know, we're already overflowing in terms of isolation centers in Lagos, for example. So if, according to the commissioner, we're going to have 120,000 cases by the summer, you know, July, August, then can we really admit them all? You know, do we need to start thinking about another way of isolating people without disrupting the rest of society? And then, you know, security plan, deployment of police and army. You know, we've had a lot of issues with security. They seem to be going down now, but as people come back to work and as people resume daily activities, you hope that we don't go back to whatever the security issues were that we had before, Boko Haram, herdsmen, different parts of the country. We haven't heard all of that since all this started. So one hopes that we're not going to return to that as we begin to sort of loosen lockdowns.
All right, doctor, interesting you didn't make mention of the statement credited to the commissioner who said there's a projection of about 120,000 cases to be recorded by July. Now, that is scary, if I should say. Should we continue the relaxed lockdown on the basis of what we know now?
Well, you know, you have to think about the greater good. So what works for this country? Lockdown, it may not be the answer. It may be that what we need to do is think about how to ensure that people don't need to go out as frequently as they have done under normal circumstances, but rigorous, you know, really embark on massive testing. I think testing is what will help us know who is exposed, who is infected, who needs to be isolated, and really plan around that so that those people who have already had the infection perhaps may be able to gently ease back into society without the fear. We don't know for sure, but perhaps they may not get infected in a short or reinfected in a short time. We don't have the evidence for that one way or the other. Then really think about the private sector, private healthcare providers. How have they been engaged? We should recognize that private sector provides about 70% of regular healthcare. So is there a way to engage the private sector creatively and ensure that people continue to get the care they need, as well as provide support and care for people who have COVID-19 infection? And then, of course, continue to shield the elderly and the vulnerable. Who are these people? Identify them. Ensure they don't have to go out to get their medications, to get food, to become unnecessarily exposed, because we can prevent the burden that they would pose to the healthcare system. I also think that a lot of NGOs and individuals have been involved in feeding the poor and the hungry and the needy. Recognize who these people are and roll them out, or roll out your palliative care through them, because they demonstrated they have the capacity to reach the people and do so in a way that is not disruptive to society. So yes, those numbers are scary, but you have to just focus on what needs to be done and keep doing. And then we have to ask ourselves, how long is this going to continue? What is a new normal going to look like for people? How are we going to continue children's education? If it goes on for the next 2 years, are we saying children won't be educated for 2 years? I think that there are ways to ensure that we bring in, again, the power of the organized private sector, for example, to ensure we can roll out broadband even to areas that are remote, and ensure that children can continue to learn through the internet, through radio, through television. We have to use everything we have at our disposal. This is not the time to segment and say, oh, this is private sector, this is public sector. This is a Nigerian response, and it should be coordinated as such.
Dr. Doherty Orode, thank you very much for joining us on the news and for your in-depth contribution.
Thank you.